Good morning and welcome to all of you. It's good to have you in worship today. We are the church where people believe, belong, and become. That's our adage. We're also the church with a big heart, and that's certainly the truth about us as well. So if you haven't signed in on the Friendship Pew Pad, please do so, and we're glad you're here today. Moving right along, we've got work coming in, albeit by article, for the Lenten booklet that we're putting together, 40 days of Lent, beginning with Ash Wednesday and a traditional service. And we're looking for contributions, maybe a little bit of inspiration that you've read and a daily devotional guide that you would like to reference and have as part of the booklet. Or in a few cases, we have folks actually writing an article or two, and it would be wonderful to have your name and authorship in our Lenten booklet. The deadline is Monday, February 13th. So we're coming close, and I'm hoping to see quite a few more articles come in. Women's Fellowship Get Together is this coming Thursday, February 2nd. It happens to be Groundhog Day, so all the women are welcome to bring their sack lunches and enjoy the fellowship. And if, as they leave the church following the luncheon, they see their shadow, 6 more weeks of winter. So just keep that in mind. We're going to pray for a sunless, cloudy day. Now, this is an odd image. It's very rare that you see our bountiful basket empty, but it actually was this week. Kathy Johnson delivered all of the wonderful cleaning supplies and contributions to our friends at the Salvation Army. But in February and March, we focus once again on giving to our local food shelf. March is Minnesota Food Share Month, so any financial contributions are matched at the state level. So please consider non-perishable goods as you shop, and we'll see what we can do to help bolster the depleted supplies at our local food shelf. I want to mention that organ repair is going along wonderfully. It's so hard to know the scale of things, but that is actually the blower motor for our wonderful, beautiful organ. And I'll just say, because I pushed it about 3 feet, that it's 250 pounds and it's a beast. That is the heart of our organ. And I want to extend a word of appreciation and thanks to Clayton Milkey, who was brains and brawn, that was able to pull that apart. I believe I read somewhere in the emails that Joe Capistrans sent that there are only 3 people in the whole state of Minnesota that could have mastered this project. And between Greg Capan and Joe Capistrans, the person behind the instigator, and of course our loved Clayton Milkey, this thing got done. And I hope by next Sunday we'll have an organ. Greg is going to say a word or two about the project, just to bring you up to speed. And Greg, will you take the mic there at the lectern?
Well, first of all, just for scale, that big black case you see there with the motor on the end of it is 3 feet across.
Uh-huh.
So it's a yard wide. That's how big it is. The motor is running 2 great big plates that are made out of aluminum with fan blades mounted on the side of them. So it needs lots of power to get that all going as it starts up. The reason it stopped working is because it's a 2-stage motor. It runs when it first starts like the starter on your car, so it has lots of power. And then once it gets up to speed, it runs a different way. And the mechanism which gives the motor the power to start up, part of that had broken down, so it was only getting half as much power to start as it needed. So it would be like trying to start your car with your battery just about dead. Mm. It couldn't quite get going fast enough to get the motor up to speed. And it was sparking all over the place because of the way that mechanism had failed. You may remember about 10 years ago, we had to have the motor fixed that time. That was the other part of the mechanism that actually turned it from startup to run. This time it was the startup mechanism on the other end of the motor that part of it had worn out after 80 years. and needed to be replaced. So we have that all in place. Now we're just waiting because the man who repaired the motor said, you know, after 80 years, you should have an electrician come in and check the rest of the wiring and the mechanism that actually starts and keeps the motor supplied with electricity and make sure all that's in good shape before you actually start trying to run it again. So the first part of this week, we have an electrician coming in to double check the rest of the wiring, and if that all checks out, we should be in shape to have the organ back by next Sunday. We'll keep our fingers crossed.
Thank you, Greg and Clayton and Joe. Job well done. Job well done. Yes, yes.
But Clayton is the one who did the physical work.
Yes, he did.
Taking it apart and cleaning it all up and putting it back together.
We're indebted to you, Mr. Clayton. Thank you. Thank you. If only they had a process or a procedure to jumpstart us when we hit 80, right? Rebuild us. And they do. That's right. Betty will testify to that. All right, with no other announcements before us other than the Herberger's Community Days, I got to get Catherine in here. My apologies, Catherine.
That's all right. I figured it was my time when that came up.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
You know, I'm very proud to belong to a church that does as much mission work as our church does.
Yeah.
Whether it be the Christmas dinner or the Tree of Lights, whatever it is, we generally are there and trying to fill a need. But it costs money frequently to do these things. And twice a year, for many, many years, we have had the opportunity to participate in Herberger Community Days. Now, I've heard the reply, and I've made it myself, Herberger's is always having a sale. But twice a year, they dedicate this sale and the proceeds whereof that they take in at the store or by all of we nonprofit groups to the nonprofit groups. Actually, they donate millions. And my pride is, I look around our churches, hey, that's local. Herberger's are local. Bob married a local girl right from this church, Dr. Kierland's daughter. It's a gift that we participate in, and when you give the $5 for the coupon book, you're not buying a book. You're donating $5 to our church, to our mission fund. In addition to getting that $5, you get a $10 coupon, so Herberger's is actually out about $10 on that donation to us, and then all the items that are available out there that day. So I just want you to know, I'll be harassing you, but I'm not alone. We have a lot of believers that think that it's a wonderful way to raise money to support our missions and our community. So every Sunday after church, we'll be out there. Herberger's Community Days are February 23rd through 25th. So they're not far off. But it's our opportunity once again, and I don't want to deprive you of that opportunity.
It's the most gentle and kind harassment I could possibly know, Catherine. Thank you. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to invite all who are able to please rise. Let's take a moment to greet one another, shall we? Good to be in worship with you today. Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you too. Yeah, good working with you. Please remain standing as we continue in worship this morning. We do love being with one another. I'd like to share a brief prayer of invocation, and then our Pastor Kathy will lead us in our call to worship. Will you bow with me for a word of prayer? Dear God, we gather together today with joy in our hearts. We thank you for the love that draws us to this place week after week, and for the genuine and rich fellowship that bless our lives daily. For your love, which finds us wherever we are on the journey of life, and for your grace and your peace and your comfort beyond human definition. As we enter this time of worship with you, lift our spirits into your presence. Oh, peace and comfort, but also guidance and purpose and hope and direction for our lives, both individually and also as your loved church. These things we pray in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, and in his ways we trust. Amen.
Please join now in our responsive call to worship. Jesus taught, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." He said that the realm of God is theirs.
We read that those who mourn are blessed. Jesus said they will be comforted.
The meek will inherit the earth. The merciful will obtain mercy.
All who hunger and thirst for rich treasures are blessed. Jesus said they will be filled.
Blessed are the pure in heart and the peacemakers. They are God's children and will see God.
Those persecuted and falsely accused are blessed. Each in the face of evil, we will rejoice. Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, sleeping thy presence, thy light. Be thou I'm looking out to see any youth among us today. I'm not seeing any unless they're... Oh, there's John Etner. By golly, he's a young at heart kid. But I'm not going to invite you forward. I think we'll move right on to our first reading of the day from the Old Testament Psalm number 15. Who shall abide in God's sanctuary is the question. This is a Psalm of David. O Lord, who may abide in your tent? Who may dwell on your holy hill? Those who walk blamelessly and do what is right and speak the truth from their heart, who do not slander with their tongue and do no evil to their friends, nor take up a reproach against their neighbors, in whose eyes the wicked are despised, but who honor those who fear the Lord, who stand by their oath even to their own hurt, who do not lend money at interest, and do not take a bribe against the innocent. Those who do these things shall never be moved. Well, all who are able, please rise.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, it's now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. It was a huge week, news-wise, for those of us who can't seem to keep the TV off or to page to the latest news internationally and nationally. There was a lot happening. There was breaking news about trade sanctions and tariffs and immigration and foreign relations. But that which rose to the top for me in the news cycle, and I'm sure for many millions of others like me, was the death of Mary Tyler Moore at the age of 80. She and Dick Van Dyke, I grew up with those two. I watched her and Dick navigate through various comedic episodes on their weekly sitcom, and I envied the family that could use humor so effectively to cope with life's inevitable challenges and setbacks. So yeah, maybe it wasn't totally real, but for me it felt like a much better way forward in terms of dealing with stress and fears than what I was experiencing in my own family at the time. When Mary got her own TV show in 1970, we all thought it was pretty cool that the setting was a TV station in good old Minneapolis, Minnesota. Folks were getting a pretty pure and unadulterated, at least Hollywood, look at what Minnesotans go through. But more importantly than that, Mary became the spunky role model for a whole new generation of single, aspiring professional women. In a male-dominated world, she pushed back at the boundaries and demonstrated quite effectively that women were every bit as capable and qualified and equal to their male counterparts in the professional world. She worked with a quirky cast, and I'm sure all of us could name each of those crazy folks that she worked with, each with her own unique human flaws and foibles. But you notice she never once judged or belittled them for their very human imperfections. Rather, Mary always took the high moral road and embraced each and every one of them. While faith was rarely explored on the show, every episode of the Mary Tyler Moore Show had at its core, I think, Christian values of hope and optimism and love for humanity and mutual acceptance and inclusion, determination and a faithful triumph over adversity. The core values of our faith and what we look like as God's loved children at our very best. I personally will miss the character of Mary Tyler Moore. I will miss her optimism and her spunk, even though Lou Grant said, "I hate spunk." Her hope, and most importantly, her all-inclusive outlook on life. What a wonderful testimony to humanity and to us. As we enter our time of prayer today, please keep Betty Anderson in your prayers. Betty, how did that procedure go?
Just like on TV.
Just like on TV. No problems. You're smiling.
It went so quickly. The doctor there gave me the stuff. And said, "Well, now I'll just fall asleep." And I opened my eyes and I said, "Where's everybody? I can't do this. It's done."
Oh, my goodness. Your heart is back in rhythm. Prayers have been answered.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. 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 That's for you, kiddo.
One of the things she said, Betty, the calmest you've been this morning is when you were praying with your pastor. The calmest my heart was. That's all of you.
Aw, thank you. Yeah, we surrounded you with love and prayer this week. We'll continue our prayers for Pastor Steve Johnson, who's still at home and still laboring with that foot that's got a bit of infection in it yet. And Mike Doxey gave me an update, and he's certainly looking forward to a surgical procedure within the next couple of weeks to fuse a couple of his vertebrae so he can be past that chronic back pain that's been so debilitating for him. And we turn our view to the greater world around us. For the detained Syrian refugees who have been thoroughly vetted for the past 2 years, who at the very last minute are being sent back home. And for our new president and our world leaders in this great, big, beautiful world that is our home. Let us keep all of that, those people individually and globally, in our prayers today. Join with me first in a time of silent prayer, and today I'm going to suggest just a little quieter than usual. As we contemplate our lives in God's care, we'll share prayers, of course, for our loved ones near and dear and for our world. I'll share a pastoral prayer, and then we'll join in the Lord's Prayer using debts and debtors. Will you bow with me now? Dear Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you who were present at the beginning of creation, and you who author new life each and every day of our lives, you who created us all in your beautiful image, you who bless us and hold us in your care and arms, hear us as we pray. Lord, we sense that we have entered into a very unique time. There is unrest, and in some ways, it's almost as if we're being tested as a nation. We have made such amazing gains in the past decades in terms of both our international and human relations, and the understanding of our environment and the delicate balance that exists between us and all living things, advancements in the sciences and a deeper understanding of the nuances and importance of a sound economy. But now we have some uncertainty about the future. And why not? We don't have a crystal ball. We can't see with any great clarity what the future will bring. Many of us are hopeful and optimistic, and still others of us are concerned and fearful. So no matter who we are on this life journey together, in that wide spectrum, help us all to know your peace and comfort and grace and love that pass all human understanding. Help us in these times to be tolerant of those who feel differently than we ourselves feel, or see the world differently than we ourselves see it. Help us continue always to reach out to one another in love, not because we have to or there's some mandate to do so, but because we recognize that we are all part of your love family, each and every one of us. We are brothers and sisters. When it comes to our nation and this great big world in which we live, help us to choose not to be a nation isolated from the rest of the world, but a nation that is vital and engaged with a beautiful and diverse global community. These are the gifts you have given us, and these are the gifts we will seek to embrace in the future. So we pray for our brothers and sisters wherever they call home, those like us and those so different from us, those who all share with us a common humanity and a universal need for home and safety, a love of family, a love of faith in you. Keep us always in your care. Hold us dear in your thoughts. Guide us as only you can through your Holy Spirit to a new day of your own design and your glorious vision. These things we pray in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us each to pray with one voice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our second reading today comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. It's found in the Pew Bible on page 4. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom in heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. And blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. May the Lord add understanding and meaning and blessing on his word this morning. We all want to live a good life. We want to live well and comfortably and productively and peacefully. We wish to enjoy the recognition and support and esteem of our neighbors. But Jesus imagines a different fate for his followers. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Jesus' expectation seems to be not that his followers wouldn't live good lives, but they would live lives for good. His expectation is that they would live for righteousness' sake, that they would live for the sake of what God wants. Sometimes these two aims overlap. Living for good makes for a good life, but not always. The New Testament consistently portrays the church as a minority community, a countercultural community, a persecuted community. And in this world, Jesus and his followers were strangers and subversives. Jesus and his followers did not do as the world did. Jesus does not give as the world gives. Instead, Jesus openly challenged the authority and integrity and values and practices of the leaders of his community. And his faithful followers are expected to do the same. Faithful followers of Jesus then and now are a subversive community, people who do not just fit in. They're the people who do not do what is expedient, but what is right. People who do not bow to the will of the majority, but submit to the one will of our Lord. People who do not accept the prevailing wisdom, but always seek the truth. They will put themselves at risk for the sake of the kingdom. They will sacrifice their own comfort and safety to save even one human soul. They believe that love is stronger than hate, that peace is not the result, but a way, that mercy is not earned, but given. They are people who speak up for those who are ignored and stand up for those who are overlooked. They defend the defenseless, they give to the poor, they challenge the proud, and console the helpless. They love God above everything else, but love, because love is the greatest commandment and their first duty. And they love even their enemies as much as they love themselves, because again, love is the greatest commandment. There are those who will protest what is wrong, and they'll protest in the streets and in the airports. Faithful followers of Jesus then and now are a subversive community. Faithful followers of Jesus then and now are a persecuted community. Authority does not like to be questioned or ignored. The conforming majority does not like to be questioned or ignored. People who go their own way, who follow their own leader, who cut against the cultural grain, are a nuisance, a threat, outcasts, troublemakers. They are to be ignored, derided, shunned, laughed at, harassed, denounced, persecuted. But wait, the church is not persecuted. The church in our community, the church in our nation is not persecuted. We do get in. We do fit in. We do get along. We are in sync with the cultural mainstream. And if this continues to be so, may God have mercy on us. How will we understand what Jesus means when he said, "Blessed are the peacemakers"? Let us start by looking at the phrase, "disturbing the peace." Disturbing the peace implies upsetting some kind of equilibrium, unsettling some kind of status quo. It conceives peace as something static, something passive. Peace is imagined as the regular state of affairs that may be disturbed and put into an uproar. This is our common notion of peace. We see peace in a negative term, the absence of conflict, the absence of turmoil, the absence of commotion, of noise, of busyness. Peace is defined by what is not there, by what is not happening. We talk about peace of mind when our minds are free of conflicting thoughts, about peace of heart when our hearts are free of conflicted feelings, about peace among friends when friends are not fighting, about peace among nations when nations are not at war. But the biblical notion of peace is different. This peace is not negative, but positive, not passive, but active, not static, but animated. This peace is not about what is not there, but about what is there. Not the absence of conflict, but about the presence of wholeness and health and well-being and justice and all the other good things that God intends for God's creation. Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers." It's creative, it's active, making peace, advocating for, bringing into the good that God intends. Jesus didn't say, "Blessed are the peacekeepers." He said instead, "Blessed are the peacemakers." It's not about keeping the peace, it's about making the peace. Peace is about advocating and healing, about helping and supporting. It's about challenging injustice and doing what is just. And sometimes that will cause a commotion. I'm guilty of disturbing the peace. I do not condone the actions recently taken to ban Muslims from entering the U.S. I do not condone the assault on women's rights. I do not condone building a wall. And I do not condone hate. We should aim to seek for wholeness for those who have been broken by what has been done to them, and to seek wholeness for those who have been broken by what they have done. Our aim should be to make peace. That the aim of each of us, the aim of this church, will be to make peace. That we will make it our aim to be peacemakers on the model of Jesus himself. Jesus said, "Such people are blessed." Jesus said, "Such people will be called children of God." Our faith requires us to ask hard questions that few of us dare to ask. The dark corners of our souls, few of us are willing to examine. The kind of absolute commitments few of us are willing to make. Exploring our faith means being ready to venture outside of our comfort zones, to leave behind what feels safe and familiar, to ask ourselves what it means, what it really means to live out our faith in a world, in the world, in a genuine way. And we know this. We know that God is enough. God is much more complex, so much more awesome, so much more real than we can begin to imagine. The command to love takes us to the foundation of our faith. Not love as we usually think of it, but as love as God does. This is what love is. It is not that we have loved God, but that God has loved us, and he sent his Son to the world. God is love, love that sacrifices everything, love that gives up everything, love that keeps on going and keeps on loving through the pain, through the hurt, through the rejection. And God commands us to love the same way, to love our neighbors and our enemies, to love with actions, not just with words. to show love for widows and orphans and aliens, for all those who've been left alone on the edges of human society. This too is a hard part of our faith. Love is a risky business, a demanding business, an exhausting business that often yields no visible results. It's so much easier to stay in those familiar places, just love those that love us back. But when you do explore your depth of faith, you will find something extraordinary, that love is eternal. Love lasts forever and is already what it will one day be. What we see now is just a dim image in the mirror. Then we will see face to face, blessed are the pure in heart. Jesus is talking to me on that hillside. And I know about being poor in spirit. I know about mourning. I know about humility. I know about being hungry and thirsty for righteousness. I even know a little bit about showing mercy. But I know nothing about being pure in heart. My heart is a mixed bag of emotions and desires and hopes and regrets. And unless I'm an alien being transplanted from some other world, and unless what I feel and experience in my heart is different from every other human being, I imagine you know what I'm talking about. I imagine that being pure in heart is unfamiliar territory to you as well. What is purity of heart? We want to have our cake and eat it too. We want to love God with all our heart, but be free at the same time to pursue all other desires, goals, and pleasures. Our hearts are divided between job and family, between duty and pleasure, between faithfulness and temptation, between trust in God and trust in myself. Is there anyone who is pure in heart? But why would Jesus give this blessing if there's no one to give it to? Why would Jesus say, "Blessed are the pure in heart," if being pure in heart is an impossibility? But Jesus said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God." I'm not sure I've been there, but I'd like to explore that. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain. After he sat down, the people gathered around him, and he began to teach them. "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are those who are humble, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who are hungry and thirsty for righteousness, for they will be filled." Are you hungry? Are you hungry for righteousness? Do you have a gnawing hunger, an aching hunger, a relentless thirst to see justice done, to see goodness prevail, to see the coming of peace to earth? Are you hungry for the day when no child will be left behind, when every child will have plenty to eat and nice clothes to wear, when every child will be safe and comfortable in a home in which to live, when every child will have ample opportunity and ready encouragement to develop and express the unique capabilities God has put in them? Are you hungry for the day when teachers and parents and human resource managers will recognize the multiple intelligences, linguistic and mathematical and spatial and musical and interpersonal and intrapersonal and naturalist, and won't try to fit every child or every job applicant into the same round hole? Are you hungry for ability awareness? For the day when we'll reap the benefits of recognizing each person's abilities instead of bemoaning their disabilities? Are you hungry for an end to drug dealing and sexual enticement and credit card pandering, to anything and everything that preys on the vulnerability of the young? Are you hungry for the day when spouses will respect and affirm their mates, when children will respect and listen to their parents, when parents will affirm and listen to their children? Are you hungry for the day when spouses will be faithful to their marriage vows for a lifetime? Are you hungry for the day when generosity will overwhelm greed, when people and nations will make decisions and take actions on mutual benefit instead of individual gain? Are you hungry for the day when people and nations will make sacrifices, even deep and risky sacrifices, just to ease another's suffering, just to soothe another's pain. Are you hungry for the day when there will be equal pay for equal work, when all glass ceilings will be shattered, when every worker, man or woman, blue collar or white collar, domestic or foreign, will be able to take pride in their work and take home enough to provide for their families? Are you hungry for the day when forgiveness will supplant revenge, when revenge will be no more than a first thought, will not be the first thought of an injured person or an offended nation, when revenge won't be thought of at all, when the cycle of violence, of injury, and retaliation will be brought to an end? Are you hungry for the abolition of the death penalty, for the day when people are convinced that no good, no justice ever comes from taking life? Are you hungry for a day when nations will study war no more? Are you hungry for the day when not a single nuclear weapon exists anywhere? Are you hungry for the name, end of name calling, an end to every kind of abuse, verbal and physical, for the day when people can walk and work and meet and play without fear and with respect? Are you hungry for the day when artists will receive the same accolades as athletes, when teachers will be considered as vital to the well-being of any society as business executives? Are you hungry for the end of dishonesty and manipulation? Are you hungry for the day when people mean what they say and say what they mean, when people will be just as eager to listen as to speak? Are you hungry for the end of fraud, deceptive advertising and spin? Are you hungry for a day when candidates for public office will not be elected because they have better name recognition, better handlers, more money, more star power, but because they have wisdom and integrity and humility and character? Are you hungry for the day when we'll treat the land and the sea and the air and all the plants and animals that fill them as an end to themselves, as things of precious value, not just a means toward the satisfaction of our needs? Are you hungry for the day when we're as passionate about justice as we are about our favorite sports team? Are you hungry for the day when our church will look like a place where everyone is welcome, where everyone belongs? Are you hungry for the day when all humanity will pray to God, "Your will be done," and do it? Do you have a gnawing hunger, an aching hunger, a relentless thirst to see justice done, to see goodness prevail, to see the coming of peace on earth? If you're that hungry, you are blessed. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountaintop. And after he sat down, the people gathered around him, and he began to teach them. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Blessed those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed those who are humble, for they will inherit the earth. Jesus saw the crowds. He didn't make an abstract statement, a generalized observation. He spoke to actual people among the crowds. And Jesus is speaking to you and to me. He's speaking to you who are humble, to you who are gentle and unassuming, to those who aren't used to being the center of attention. You nice men and you nice women, you are blessed. In this country, in this culture, we like winners. We measure a person by their victory, a business by their profit, a nation by their domination in the world order, a church by the number of its members and the grandeur of its facilities. But Jesus likes nice guys. He says they will inherit the earth. He says they are blessed. Jesus went up to that mountaintop and scattered among the crowds. He saw people who were poor in spirit. And what did he say to them? He said, "You are blessed. The kingdom of heaven belongs to you. The kingdom of heaven that matters more than anything else. The kingdom that wise people seek before everything else. The kingdom of heaven that's so precious to people that give away anything just to have it. The kingdom of heaven that means rest and peace, gentleness and wholeness and justice, life and freedom and intimacy with God. The question is, to whom does this kingdom of heaven belong? It belongs to those who are poor in spirit. You might expect the answer to be to the saints. The kingdom of heaven belongs to the saints and to those who have worked hard for God's reward, to those who have proven themselves worthy of God's blessing, to those who are dedicated, those who are especially faithful, to those whose faith is especially strong, to those who may be materially poor but spiritually rich. But Jesus says the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are poor in spirit. And what does it mean to be poor in spirit? What does it mean to be poor? To be poor means having few resources. It means having to make a little go a long way. To be poor means every day is hard, not easy. It means every day is a struggle just to survive. To be poor means feeling left out, overlooked, ignored, unblessed. Being poor in spirit means the same thing. It means having few spiritual resources. It means having to make a little faith go a long way. It means every day is a struggle just to hold on to your faith. Being poor in spirit means feeling left out, overlooked, ignored, unblessed. I call, I cling, I want, but there is no one to answer. No one on whom I can cling. No one. I feel alone. Where is my faith? Even deep down, right in there is nothing but emptiness and darkness. My God, how painful is this unknown pain. I have no faith. I dare not utter the words and thoughts that crowd in my heart and make me suffer untold agony. So many unanswered questions live within me, afraid to uncover them because of the blasphemy. If there be God, please forgive me. When I try to raise my thoughts to heaven, there is such convicting emptiness that those very thoughts return like sharp knives and hurt my very soul. I am told God loves me, yet the reality and the darkness and the coldness and the emptiness is so great that nothing touches my soul. Darkness is such that I really do not see, neither with my mind nor with my reason. The place of God in my soul is blank. There is no God in me. When the pain of longing is so great, I just long and long for God. The torture and pain I cannot explain. That's poor in spirit. And do you know who wrote those words? It was not me. Mother Teresa. And as she wrote these words and others like them, she was not a young woman before she began her work tending to the poorest of the poor in Calcutta, India. But all the while that she did her work until the end of her life, she served God, and she served God by serving the poor, even as she struggled with her experience of God's absence in her own life. And so Mother Teresa is blessed. The kingdom of heaven belongs to her, not because of her good works, but because of her poverty of spirit. Not because she proved herself worthy, but she knew herself to be empty. She knew she was empty of faith, of assurance, of the palpable sense of the presence of God that she so desired. There is a difference between spiritual poverty and spiritual apathy. Jesus declares, "Blessed are those who are poor in spirit." Not blessed are those who just don't care. Spiritual poverty is measured relative to spiritual desire. When we desire God, when we desire faith, when we desire certainty, we are more conscious of their absence. And so what shall we do? First of all, nothing. You should do nothing. Jesus does not give us a command. He makes us a promise. Jesus offers a promise of God's blessing to people who are poor in spirit. If you are poor in spirit, and if you know all too well that you are, if you know your faith to be weak and your spiritual struggle to be great, if you want so much to know God, but don't, if you are poor in spirit, don't fear it. The kingdom of heaven belongs to you. Take advice from another Christian who's been there, Julian of Norwich. She writes, "Pray, even if you feel nothing, see nothing. For when you are dry, empty, sick, or weak, at such a time your prayer is most pleasing to God, even though you may find little joy in it. This is true of all believing prayer. Blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to you. Amen.
With burnt offerings, nor impressed by the size of our gifts. God wants our full commitment and loving devotion, of which our giving in these moments is only a symbol. God calls us to lives of mercy and peacemaking, respect and love for all people, for which our offering can make a new beginning. Will the ushers please come forward? Will all who are able please rise?
Praise God from whom all blessings.
With me in our unison prayer of dedication. We devote ourselves and these tokens of our thankfulness toward the realization of your reign among us, Holy God. We pray for your purity of heart as we hunger and thirst for righteousness, and as we seek to be peacemakers. We rejoice in this opportunity to share in the extension of your realm. Bless us and our offering. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Showing by our lives his grace.
Please join me now in the response of benediction. Walk blamelessly before God and do what is right. Speak the truth to all from your heart.
We will honor and fear God each day. May our words and deeds resist all evil.
Consider your call and live righteously. Know that God chooses you for a blessing.
We delight in seeking to do God's will. We are awed that God appoints and blesses us.
Rejoice and be glad, for God offers rich rewards. From God you receive wisdom and true power.
We are amazed at the responsibility God gives us.
We rejoice in the blessings God promises.
Amen.